At this time, we're going to receive our speaker for this morning. Amen. I don't have her bio, but I wanted to just give you all a small inclination of what Sister Cora, Evangelist Cora Carter, is going to be ordained minister, Cora Carter, on today, of what she is to New Vision New Day. She has been with us, and since she has come into this ministry, she has been a powerhouse and a blessing. She has a very warm spirit, and she draws people to her. She's an encouraging spirit. She is the first person after us being here in 14 years of ministry. That's all right. Salute your lady. Amen. She came to us and she said, "You know what? I see that you all don't have an usher board." And she says, "I would like to put together an usher board for New Vision New Day. That's what I want to do for my church." And she put together an usher board. She put together a team that is excellent. And I mean, she is no nonsense, meaning she makes sure that they are on their post. She makes sure that they have the right attitude. They do it in a spirit of love. And she just is always concerned about making sure that when people come to the house of God, they feel welcome as they walk through that door. Not only that, that they feel the love of Christ when they walk through the door. And she has done an outstanding job. But now God has even called her to a higher place. And I believe that he's going to use her mightily. I'm going to ask if you would stand to your feet and receive Minister Cora Carter. She's coming to us to give us what we call her trial sermon. In the spirit of Christ, I want you to point to her with your right hand. Say, "Preach the word." Preach the word. Minister Carter. Preach the word. Preach the word. Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God today, everybody. Don't get cold on me. Keep on praising the Lord. Lift on me. Keep on praising the Lord. Lift up the name of the Lord. He is worthy to be praised. I thank you today. I thank each and every one that has came out to support me today. I thank him, God, because he has saved me. He sanctified me, and he filled me with the precious Holy Ghost. I thank God because it's in him that I live and have my beings. I thank and praise God because without him, I'm nothing. Without him, I can't move. I couldn't even wake up this morning without him. So many people take life for granted. But honey, don't take life for granted because it's him that did it. It wasn't an alarm clock that woke me up this morning. Oh, no. You may think it was, but it was God. Hallelujah. I'm standing here to tell you, I thank God for this shepherd of this house. Woo! I thank God because I've been under his teaching, and this man can teach and preach and will lead you the right way. Hallelujah. You can't. Family also. Thank you all for being here. Thank God. Only thing that I want to do here today. One of these days,
We are all going to stand before God. And I'm going to tell y'all one thing. You better be ready to meet your maker, because he's coming. He's coming. And the only thing I want him to say to me, well done, thy good and faithful servant. I'm going to do the will of the Father that sent me today. I'm not going to look back or behind me, but I'm looking forward. I don't care if nobody don't like it. I'm going to tell what the Lord told me to bring forth today. If you don't like it, get up and go on out the door. But this minister right here is going to lift the name of the Lord up. So I need y'all to pray for me, to pray for my strength. See, God puts us in the time and place, his time and place. He has something for me to do, but I didn't realize this is what it was. We're not working on our time, but we're working on God's time. He has a purpose for our life today. Each and every one of you, there's a purpose for your life. You're not here just to hear me today. Don't look at me. Look at the God that's within me. Praise God. Praise God. And I just like to start off to say, on my message today, it begins with me. Okay? God had to work with me first. And once he works with me on this message, I can release it to you. I can release it to you now because he has worked with me on it. Praise God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I would like to turn, I'm going to get right into my message today. Also, about 2 or 3 weeks ago, Bishop touched a little bit on my message. I was in my seat. I was getting down like, oh, Lord. Woo, Bishop going to preach my message. I got kind of a little shaky there. But you know what? That just gave me the confirmation that this is what I'm supposed to speak on today. Confirmation, Bishop, confirmation that this is what the word that the Lord desires me to speak on today. I would like to bring your attention to Revelations, the 2nd chapter, starting with verse 1. Praise God. Hallelujah. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things he that holdeth the 7 stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the 7 golden candlesticks. I know thy works. I know thy labor and thy patience, and how thou cannot bear them, try them which they are of apostates and of not, and have found them liars, and have borne and have patience, and for my name's sake they labored and have not fainted. But nevertheless, I have somewhat something against you. Okay, I got something against you, Jesus. And you know what it is? Because thou hast lost your first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent. Do your first works, or else I will come unto you quickly and remove my candlestick. I will put judgment against you. I will remove my candlestick out of your place. Except thou repent. But this thou hast, that thou hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. These people were people that worship idols. They didn't believe in worshiping God. God loves everybody. You can sit down. God loves everybody, good or bad, but he hates sin. He hates sin. I would like to bring to your attention, we're still focusing on Revelations, the church of the Ephesus. The Apostle John written the things which he has seen. Now he proceeds to write the things that are according to the commands of God, which is the present state of the seven churches of Asia. He had a tender concern. He was directed to write to the circumstances and to inscribe every letter to the angels of the church. To the minister, the ministry of the church, called angels, because they were messengers of God to mankind. These letters were also dictated for their spiritual growth. We need to grow, saints. Grow. Don't stay at a standstill. If you find yourself just standing there, not growing, is something wrong. Search yourself. Search yourself. If something's missing there. If I had visited the church of Ephesus today, here's what we would have discovered in it. In an intimate matter, the present and God conversated with his churches. He knows and observes their states that they're in. He takes pleasure in them. He took pleasure in his churches. Though Christ is in heaven, he walks in the midst of us right here in our churches on earth. God is in every church. He's in the church. But we have to have the glory in the house of the Lord. There's so many things that's not of God. But God will not dwell in a place that's not right. He won't dwell there, saints. He observed what is in the midst of them. There is a great encouragement to those who have the care of the churches that the Lord Jesus has given them upon the palm of their hand. Christ, he commended his churches. Yes, he did. He commended them and the members for some good things they had did. Everybody do good things. But it's not enough to do good things. It's good. But the main thing is, give your life to Jesus Christ. Be born again. God sent his word of evaluation to the churches of Ephesus. Like I say, he knows their work, their labor. They did not faint. Christ, he keeps account on every work and deed that we do in this body. Believe that. Every hour, the work that we put in this, doing his work, he haven't forgot you. He don't forget you. Long as you're doing his will, he will not forget his people. Your work won't be in vain, church. Whatever you do for Christ will last. It will not be in vain. They're patient in suffering, endurance, hardness as a good soldier. And no Christian should be without it. We will meet certain difficulties, pain, sorrow. This way ain't easy. It's not easy. Don't you believe when somebody tell you you get saved, everything gonna go smooth. Because I'm here to tell you it's not. But he that endure until the end, the same shall be saved. Sometimes God takes us through trials and tribulations to bring us closer to him. I was thinking about when I was going through these 4 years of sickness with my husband, Deacon Larry Carter. Stand up, babe. That's my baby right there. Woo! I thank God because God has brought this man a long way. One thing about it, he didn't give up. He was so sick at one time. And this happened after he got in the church, when he got sick. See, the attacks of the enemy are many. There are many attacks of him. But the Lord will bring us out of all of them. He'll bring you out. When Deacon Carter gotten sick and everything, we prayed. I kept encouraging him. I kept saying, honey, this was time. I'm not going to sit here and test him and lie. It was hard for him. We struggled a few times. He wasn't working. I wasn't working. I had to quit. I took care of my husband. I don't know if people do that nowadays, but I tell you what I did. I took care of mine. I kept him encouraged. I said, stay with the Lord. Don't leave him. Don't forsake him. I said, our blessing is coming on the way. It's coming. And through all this, God has blessed him. He's looking good. He always been a good looking man to me anyway. I'm just saying. But honey, he looks even better now. And you know what? It's because of God. The God. I thank God for my church family. Oh, Lord, I ain't going to leave them out. I ain't going to leave my church family. I'm going to tell y'all. This is why I'm here, the love. We didn't have a dime. After he got sick, we didn't have the income coming in yet. We didn't have the income. I said, Lord, I'm not going to worry because I know you got me. This church family right here blessed us. They didn't have to do it, but they blessed us. That's called love. That's called they had got back. They was at their first love and it's still there. They could have said, oh, they'll be all right. But no, they didn't do that to me. My family stood by me. My family was there for me, too. I thank God for them. Oh, praise God. I would like to say he sent his words of evaluation to the church of Ephesus. He knew everything about them. The church of Ephesus, they had no tolerance for wicked people, for false prophets, and called themselves apostles who are not. In spite of all their characteristics, the rebuke was still given to the church. Nevertheless, I still got something against ye that I have a serious flaw. In other words, there's something wrong with y'all. You had left your first love, not left or forsaken the object of it, but lost the fervent degree of it that it had first appeared. If I could use for a little text or title, however you want to take it, it would be, get back to your first love. Get back, saints. For some people, they say they love. But you know what? I'm going to explain to some people what love really means. The definition of love. It's a strong feeling, a warm affection, to be in love with someone or something, lovable, beautiful, delightful, compassion for others. Some might say, well, Sister Cora, what do you mean by I left my first love? I'm here to tell you right now. Your love for Christ, your affections toward him, and holiness in heaven. You used to be lively and warm. What happened to all of that? Church, what happened? What happened? Your love has cooled off. You got lacking. You laid back. What happened? You cooled off. You can't even get nobody to stand up and praise the Lord anymore. You have to beg somebody to get up and say, thank you, Jesus. We shouldn't have to do that, saints. Get back to your first love. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Jesus, your great care has not been taken. Christ is grieved and displeased with his people today. When he see that they grow love, they grow cold toward him. Oh, hallelujah. I was just so grieved. God is grieved, saints. Don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Don't be cold toward God. Don't be cold. Be on fire for the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Hallelujah. Because either one way or the other, he's gonna let you know. Our love has fallen for our brothers and sisters. Sometimes we need to fall on our knees and repent and do your first works over. Don't get so big-headed and pride set in. Every now and then you may fall. Are you going to stay there or are you going to get back up? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Saints, let's not let this happen to our lives and our churches today. Like I said, we need to search ourselves. Have we allowed our love for the Lord to diminish, to grow small? Have you let your love go? Jesus, I'd like to give you some examples. How do we know when our love is draining away? Can I talk to you for a minute? Just 1 minute. How much time do you spend with God? When you wake up in the morning, you're on your way to work, you got your busy day. You can at least take 5 or 10 minutes out your morning to say, Lord, help me. Thank you for waking me up. Carry me on through my day. If God is not first in our thoughts, in our efforts in the morning, he gonna be in the last place the remainder of the day. If you don't wake up and acknowledge him in the morning, he's gonna be the last person that you think of. Do you want to do that to the Lord? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Another example, you no longer have a regular conversation with the Lord, asking him for guidance and protection through your day. Are you too busy for him? Imagine the Lord sitting at your breakfast table waiting on you. He waiting for you to come downstairs and acknowledge him and sit there. But you leave him sitting there. And you're going about your way. Are we going to leave God sitting at our kitchen table? Oh, no, 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 no. Don't leave him sitting there, saints. Have you allowed your habits to overtake you contrary to his word? Oh, boy, habits. Let me elaborate on that a little bit. Oh, God knows my heart. I can go ahead, I do this little bit of sin. He gonna forgive me all. God said, my spirit will not always strive with you. You know to do wrong. You know that it's wrong, and you keep getting up every day doing wrong, 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 and expect God to forgive you. You know you're wrong. You know you're sinning. Oh, he knows my heart. Yeah, he know your heart, all right. He know it's, amen. He know that it's wicked toward him. The eyes of the Lord are every place beholding the good and the evil. His eyes are everywhere. See, the devil can't be at the same place all the time, but God, he's there all the time. He's with us everywhere. He's with us everywhere. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. John 14:15, it says, obedience, this is another way that you know your love is draining. Disobedient is a way. Obedience is a way of expressing our love for him. When God speaks to you and tell you to do something, you better do it. When you hear that soft voice, I know the voice of the Lord. But I know when God is talking to me when I hear his voice. If somebody's screaming and talking all crazy, that's the devil. You better go somewhere and check. God don't scream and holler at you and like you crazy. That ain't God. That ain't God. God speaks to you softly. A little boy, peace, calm like a water, river water. He speaks to his children that way. And don't let nobody tell you nothing different. When was the last time you said, Jesus, I love you? I wake up every morning and say, good morning, Holy Spirit. Tell him, say, good morning, Holy Spirit. When you go to bed at night, say, good night, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Say, Jesus, I love you. In Psalms 18:1 says, I will love you, O Lord, my strength. Another one, I'm almost done. Are you waiting and waiting with excitement, anticipation for Christ's return? That's another way you know your love is draining. You're not waiting. You're out here doing everything under the sun. You're waiting to wait. You want God to, you wait for his return. Sometimes things get so bad out here, I say, Lord, please hurry up and come. It said, even so, Lord, come, Lord Jesus. But I said, Lord, you give me the strength to go through this because it's rough. Paul seems to suggest in 2 Timothy 4:8, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearance. Are you loving and waiting for Jesus to come? Are you waiting for his appearance? Praise God. I'm waiting. I'm fearing the Lord. Fear does not mean tremble, shaking, and scared. It means to reverence God. Be on your best behavior because you know he's coming. You're fearing him. You don't want to do nothing wrong because you fear him. Praise God. Hallelujah. We can also get caught up with everything, everybody, life itself. We put everything before God. There's different kinds of love. There's love for your mate, your parents and child, and your friends. A husband and wife, sometimes, when you first get married, you be all in love. Can't nobody tear you apart. You're all hugged up, kissed up, whatever. And then 6 months later, you see somebody, they with somebody else. You be like, what the world? What happened? They lost the love. The love is cooled down for each other. The love has cooled down. Praise God. Praise God. Get back to your first love. You can rekindle your first love. Sometimes you go back to your court when you first dated. Go back to that sometime and remember how you met when you first dated. Maybe that can build a little fire up. Praise God. And that's the same way with God. Go back. Go back to your first love with God. Go back. How wonderful it was when he saved you. He saved you from hell by his own suffering. That's when you discovered eternal life. You walked with him in abiding fellowship. When you first got saved, you wanted to save the whole world. Everybody you saw, Jesus loved you. Died on the cross, but you were just so enthused, so happy to tell the world about Jesus. You had your Bible. Everywhere you went, you had your Bible. Now people don't carry their word with them. Cell phone. Yes, sir, Bishop. I carry. This is my sword and my shield, honey. I carry my Bible everywhere I go. If I go to the grocery store, if I forget, I go right back in the house and get it. Because you need the word to fight this devil. I plead the blood of Jesus over everything. You got to plead the blood. If not, the devil world will take you. This power in the name of Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. We used to fast, we used to pray. What happened to that? How's your prayer life? Do you wait till Sunday like we are today? And praise God, jump up and shout, can anybody sit you down? What are you doing on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday? Some people don't have no prayer life, but when they get in trouble, they go call it on Jesus. Don't wait until Sunday. You have to have a prayer life to keep in touch with Jesus. Have an intimate relationship with him. Jesus. Get back to your first love. The Bible say man should always pray and not faint. How do you think we get our power? Through prayer. Through connection. Through talking with your father, having a conversation with him. It ain't just, oh, get up, thank you, Jesus, wake me up, get up, and go about your day. No, God wants more than that. He wants an intimate, to be intimate with somebody. You know what intimate means? That's what God wants from us. He wants us to have that kind of relationship with him. Hallelujah, praise God, hallelujah. Over in Proverbs 24:6, it says, a just man falleth seven times and riseth up again, but the wicked shall fall into mister. We may fall. There's nothing wrong with getting on your knees, repenting. Don't worry about what people say about you. Don't worry about what people think about you. You better worry about pleasing God. That better be your first thing in life. Worry about pleasing God and not man. Everybody's not going to like what you say and what you do, but you're not pleasing man. I made up my mind, I don't give a care about what nobody say about me. I'm going to do the will of what my father, he sent me. I'm going to do it. I'm going to please him. Hallelujah. Because on that day, he ain't going to ask you, but what about Sister so-and-so? He going to say, Minister Cora, you didn't do what I told you to do. I told you to preach my word. I told you to go on and bring a soul in. I told you to help that poor person. I told you to do this. I told you to do that. You stand before God. He don't want to hear no excuses because it's going to be too late. It's going to be too late. Get your life in order right now. Repent. Renew your commitment to his works. Don't let bitterness, strife, envy settle in. We need to ask God to help us. Rededicate yourself to him. I was saved at an early age, 8 years old. I remember on my knees praying. I was a little girl. My mother always brought us up in the church. My dad, we knew the way. But I stepped out of the will of God. I was out there. I wasn't always saved. And I'm not going to sit here and tell you I was, because I wasn't. I stepped out of the will of God. I wanted to get out here and dib and dab and see what the world was like. But God had a calling, his hand on my life. He said, this is what you're going to do. This is where I want you to be. This is right in my sight. I'm going to save you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It also speaks on Jesus saying Jesus is closer today coming than he was yesterday. The Bible speaks on the love of many. How do we know? The love of many has waxed cold for God and also for our brothers and sisters. We hear of all this hate, this killing, these rumors of war, everything, ISIS, whatever. But you know what? That's why you need to pray for God's protection and shield on your life. Like Bishop said, it was in my message, I thank God. Bishop have a lot of confirmation, I'm telling you. He said, black lives not only matter. All lives matter to God. Okay? It's time that people come together. It's not about race. It's not about race. Praise God. Hallelujah. Sometime, I remember years ago, you used to can talk to people and smile. How you doing? How you doing? You better not do it now. You reach over and say hi. They might pull out a gun and shoot you. That's just how bad things is now. You never know. But you got to stay under the protection of the Lord. Stay under God's protection. He laid down his life for us. What is we as Christians doing? Hallelujah, hallelujah. We're living in a world where there's big eyes and little U's. You stop that. Stop it right now if you're doing it. Think about your brothers and sisters. It's not all about you. Where's your love? How do we know that we are God's children? As we show love to God and one another. Hallelujah. We shouldn't have to look outside the church for love. Love begins right here. It begins right here in the church. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Is sometime a hug and a kiss can just help somebody? Don't tear each other down. Build each other up. You don't know what that person might have been going through. Hallelujah. I'm almost finished here. But I'm the type of person, don't let me get your phone number. Because if I don't see you two or three Sundays, I'm calling you. Sister, you back there clapping. I've been calling you too. I've been calling you. I'm going to call and check on a bishop. I'm going to say, oh, how are you doing? Are you okay? Can I help you with something? Would you like a word of prayer? I miss you. I'm not talking about being nosy in somebody's business. That's not what I'm talking about. There's a difference with being nosy and concerned. There's a difference of being nosy, yes, sir, and concerned. Okay, sometimes we lose patience with people. Be happy for somebody. I'm happy for people. Some people have a better job, a larger paying salary. Some people experience more prosperity in some kind of way. Your blessing is on its way. It's on its way. Hallelujah. I'd just like to say, some people love to bring things, this is my closing. Some people like to bring things in your face and throw up your past. Every time you see them, girl, I remember. I don't do that no more. Because the Bible say, I'm a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. My hands is new and my feet is too. I thank God that he saved me. I thank God that he delivered me. I thank God that he brought me out. Hallelujah. I don't want to do the things that I used to do anymore. I don't go to places that I used to go anymore. Because God has saved me. He filled me with his love. He filled me with his joy. He filled me with his peace. And I thank you. I thank him. Praise God. I'm asking you to pray my strength in the Lord that God would keep me humble before his feet. Thank you.